Hi, and good afternoon, good morning to all of you. Myself, Kinjal Vora, I am a marketing head at Drona HQ, and I would like to extend a warm welcome to each of you, our dynamic divas out here on this Women's Day, to come and share with us a journey that you have been through in the technology industry. Thank you for gracefully accepting my invitation and, you know, come here and share with all the young women who are out there who aim and plan to have a career in tech.
Hi there. Thanks for inviting me here.
Seema, with 15 years of experience in ex-LVMH and currently working as a senior product manager at L'Oreal Digital Services Factory, Seema collaborates with beauty tech partners to bring the AR and AI enabled services. L'Oreal's beauty brands. She leads the AR partnerships for L'Oreal with social media giants like Facebook, Instagram, Google, YouTube, and more. Seema has previously worked for more than 12 years for ERP projects, technical integrations, SharePoint portals, and buying and planning tools. She has also led project management teams for various industries like luxury fashion, apparel, building materials, and more. She manages end-to-end delivery, including budgeting, planning, vendor evaluation, vendor management, steering committee to ensure timely project delivery within cost and budget. Seema, quite an elaborate and interesting profile you have. Wow, AR and AI for beauty tech. Isn't that just you, Seema?
You know, I was imagining I would not have to put on makeup here and just have a way a Zoom filter applies on you and you are ready for the meeting. So that is seriously the thing that we are doing. Like, that's my current job description. We create, you know, a way for girls like us, women like us, to be able to simply try on makeup in the comfort of their home with their smartphone. You like that lipstick? Oh, I think I like the shade that Kinjal is wearing. I want to have the same shade. And that's something that we do, you know, when making beauty accessible. And really, it's not about creating unrealistic beauty, those filters which you feel are not true to, you know, but it's really about allowing makeup on yourself. So just the way you are, just adding that product and showing you how it looks on you. So that's simply we do. And it's really cool. Like, everything in my phone, I have videos filled with us trying on our own products. Like when we create, develop new services, you're just like full of, you know, trying new hair color, trying new lipsticks, trying new eyeshadow, those which you think that maybe I won't be able to know how to do that, but you can simply try on with a click of a button on your phone. So that's simply
truly
what I do.
Truly fascinating, and every girl's dream job. Seema, your experience has been into various different projects, from digitalization to AR, AI projects for L'Oreal, even before that with Louis Vuitton, some interesting projects. And at year in India, you were also part of the ERP planning, and that was completely different. How did you manage a complete shift from, say, ERP to luxury fashion, beauty tech? What is your story all about?
Thanks, Kinjal, for letting, you know, giving this platform for me. Just to tell you, I would say how was I inspired to get into engineering was, I think back in the school, my principal, I would definitely tell that she was one lady who inspired me, because I was really shy at school. But the way she built the confidence in me, today there are so many coaching, you know, when you're doing that 10th standard, you have a coaching stage where you want to know which is the right, you know, career path for you. Back in our days, in when I, you know, in 1998-99, that did not exist. But somehow that, you know, our lady Mangala Soni, she had this thing in her, the vision in her. She told me, I think I see you well, you know, doing a computer engineering, like going into engineering. I had absolutely no idea what engineering is. At that time, really, our curricular is defined in a way you want to clear your 10th standard with good results. You want to go target a science stream for your 12th. And I said, okay, I think, you are inspiring me, because I never thought about it. I don't even know. I was thinking, maybe I will do medicine. Maybe I'll do engineering. Maybe teaching, you know, you don't know really what you want to do. So, okay, I said, you know, she has something in her. She has seen me growing, like I was in the same school for my whole education. So I said, okay, I will keep this in mind and I'll come back to you and tell you if I, you know, take engineering. So it happened, like it was supposed to happen. So I got into, you know, thanks to Women Quota, I would say I was able to get into the first round of engineering, being on merit. Things were very different back then. I would be proud to say that I was able to fund my own education. I did not depend on my parents to, you know, say, okay, this is, you know, we need to spend lakhs of money for, you know, your education. So I would say, I said, my dad, don't worry, we'll get education loan. I know you would be able to fund it, but I want to be on my own. So I know that I have to repay that loan. So which is my responsibility to find the job, like finishing my college. So I was like, you know, most of you girls, I got my placement through engineering college, and I started with Larsen & Toubro Infotech. So, and there, of course, you are like, I did electronics engineering. So I was not really as well versed with, you know, IT and stuff, but you are in an IT company and then you are like out there navigating yourself, like what you really want to do. And then, of course, things are like you are destined to say, okay, now you go into this BU, which is doing ERP. You actually don't know whether Java is better or doing an ERP career is better. So we said, okay, you know, luck has brought you here. Be it so, I will be there. But then honestly, in the training, I learned that I cannot code. I mean, I'm not someone meant to code. So in the ERP stream, we really had a way where we could actually do administration. So I was really doing administration of that ERP tool, which is really was supposed like written in rock that it is meant for boys. I don't know why they were like, when I started, we had projects where there were night shifts. So they said, okay, what would you do here? Like a girl doing administration of an ERP, because you have to do maintenance jobs. You have to be, you know, supporting client 24/7. And most of the times you have to end up doing night shifts. I said, I understand that. Perhaps I wouldn't be able to be part of this project, but maybe I will find my way. So that is what it is. Like within 2 years, I got my first opportunity to go on a client role, like go you know, visit the client teams. So it just inspires to say that, okay, within like first 2 years, you're able to get your first, you know, on-site trip, and you could actually see the client themselves, because back in offshore, you don't know how business is happening. You, unless you actually see the client and be on there, you know, on the floor, you see how things are actually happening, and versus the bubble you have, like the offshore teams create a bubble, like, okay, this is the delivery, you have to do that. And but then you actually interact with client to understand what is real business need and how what you are doing contributes to the whole picture. And so you know, it was more about, okay, really building about your career in ERP. I said, okay, I feel like I have a way where I want to evolve into management, really going to not just doing the technical part. So that's where I got this opportunity, which wasn't very easy. Like I had to compete with my colleagues of mine to get this role where I was supposed to replace someone and come to France. That's really was a very difficult decision, because you had to move for a longer duration, like really leave your country, come on a bigger project. And I am not coming alone, because I was just about to get married. So my point was like, is my husband ready to be able to, you know, really come with me? And so that was like one big decision, we would say, we took in life, like a bet. Of course, thankfully, we were young. I would not be able to take the same bet now. But there, you know, we took that bet. He said, I think, you know, you should go for it. I would follow you. Don't worry about, you know, what I would do in terms of my career. And might also, you see, like where I am. This like the huge role is him, because he has sacrificed kind of his you know, career at that time to say that, don't worry, I'll figure out myself, you go. And then he joined me, leaving his, you know, role in India and trying to navigate through France, because in France, you don't know language, you can't do much. So it's really important to, you know, know the language. So first thing he did, he was like, I will take lessons. You do your, you know, take this new role, which was challenging, because you're leading like a delivery role with being in the client location. And I had to really orchestrate like delivery management for a new transformation of an ERP. And you had to do like the fact that you are coordinating with 100 people at a time. You had a strict deadline, like you had to deliver versions, but then also make sure that it's bug free. It's having its whole, like, you know, all the documentation is there. You have your stakeholders who are aligned, and they are going to, you know, take those versions. So it was very interesting. Like back if I remember, when I remember, I was like 28, 27. I think I got a great opportunity. Sometimes I compare myself to that 10 years old self, and I say that, babe, you were like really, you know, had much more confidence. Sometimes we keep questioning ourselves, like we have that imposter syndrome. But we forget that, you know, you are here because of whatever you have done in the past. So I would say women, like, we don't have to keep questioning ourselves. I think we are every day you are doing things and you keep, you know, believing in yourself, which is really more important to keep reminding, like, yes, you are there because you have done things, and, you know, keep trusting in yourself, go push it hard, which is, so that is where the thing happened. Is I was there in for two years in France within this role, but then I started to realize that you know, things are not easy, and maybe you know, I want to no more be a part of an IT consulting, and I want to kind of be a part of the organization, because at Lafarge, at this role there where I was in France, I couldn't take decisions certainly because I was a consultant. So you felt like you want to, you know, cross that barrier where you could be owning certain decisions because you can see clearly that they make sense for the business. So how I can be part of the organization. And honestly, when I, you know, when I got the opportunity at Celine, it's a part of LVMH group. It's a luxury brand. I did not even know that Celine existed. Of course, we all know LVMH. We all knew Louis Vuitton, but Celine is a niche brand. They were not really about marketing and communication. So, I was like, okay, I know what is this brand about and why are they looking for someone in my role? It was very weird because I was like, I don't even know what would I do in that role. And there was a whole risk because the visa that I was supposed to, you know, I wanted to continue living in France, but they had to really process the whole visa thing for me because I was not able to use the same visa that I came for. So it was a bet. Like, okay, I said, I will leave my previous company. I'll take this bet and we will see how it turns out. And, you know, things happened. Like, I did not know French. They told me, don't worry, but you have to learn because that is your, you know, the condition that we are, you know, accepting you. You will learn French. I said, don't worry. You give me lessons. I would put my best to, you know, learn French. And here I am, like, you know, I when I speak to my colleagues at L'Oreal, they will be like, how do you know very so good French? Because a lot of times Indians, when we want to, even if we move to another country, we are always surrounded by, which is our comfort, of course. I mean, there's no wrong feeling about it. But we do not try to, you know, mix as much as in the culture. I said, honestly, if I had not been gotten that job, I would have been in a situation where I'm comfortable speaking my English and do not really want to learn the French language. But it really helps in terms of integrating the culture. I think as Indians, we all have lived in different cities. Even in India, it's almost like going to a new country because be it what, you have to know a bit of the local language, Marathi or Kannada if you're living in Bangalore. You do learn that. So I see, like, the same way. I think we are adaptable. We do that. And I did that. So I learned French. And so at Celine, it was really about how I am, you know, now owning my budgets, owning the roadmap. And what I see the opportunity was transformation in terms of really bringing the digital transformation in the company, because they were doing things in a traditional way. Fashion, luxury fashion is quite, you know, the way it's a big monster. It is now really taking so much, it's slowly moving in terms of, you know, becoming agile and digital. So I said, okay, I'll take this bit opportunity to, you know, push myself and see how I can bring, you know, an agile transformation. So starting with small projects, like, you know, we did not have Office 365 at that time. We did not have SharePoint, but we said, okay, we'll have SharePoint. We'll see how we can start moving, you know, in this space. And then from there, little projects that exposed me to B2B, not exactly B2C, but B2B. And also I said, I'm really excited about digital. So how I can really orient my career towards digital? Like, I have done a lot of ERP, I have done a lot of B2B, B2E. I want to really see how I can, you know, really touch consumers through my ideas. And that's where I think the name that came to, you know, my mind was L'Oreal, because L'Oreal it has been a leader in terms of digital transformation and really about how they do things. And I would say I was lucky to forget this opportunity where I am currently. It was the whole team was just created when I joined. They acquired a new startup called Modiface that does augmented reality. And when we asked the question, we would say, what is L'Oreal doing about augmented reality or selling makeup products, and then you're talking about augmented reality and technology. So it was a bit crazy from when people looked from the outside. But we had, like, what I would say, what we were driving towards is a clear vision that says, okay, you know, today the challenge that consumers have, like, it was because of a need, a pain point. When I'm buying lipstick online, I don't know today exactly how that shade looks on me. You see those models, but you're not really able to identify with them. So how would you make sure that that shade looks good on me? That's a real need. So that's where the vision was, that we will use this technology, bring it to every point. And my role has been doing that. Like, I'm really seeing how I can bring this technology. We brought it to all our brands' websites, to our brands' apps when you're buying in store. But then not just that, because people are also, you know, buying on Facebook or Instagram or even on Google. So how we can bring it everywhere? So whenever they are looking for a product from a brand, they would get the same experience. So if you're trying the lipstick, you will have the same shade as it is you're swatching on yourself, like on trying any in the store, in physical world, and then in versus in this augmented reality world. And we keep doing things like we do sometimes put a real lipstick versus, you know, an augmented reality, and, you know, keep doing games. Okay, tell us which one is the real. And people are not able to guess that. So that is where the power of technology is, that they don't really find the difference between which is the augmented reality version and which is the real version. So from there, today we are taking this step ahead in terms of how, and because of pandemic, things have changed. Like, the digital transformation has just accelerated. And I think this, you all girls have also seen this in your different roles, that today there is no other way for companies to migrate these crises versus being digitally advanced. I think Indian companies, we are doing great. In India, like, we kind of also have a digital native approach, but which is not the case. Sometimes we imagine Europe, it's still taking time for people to buy online. It's not exactly the same, you know, when we are buying on Flipkart or Amazon, the accessibility. Here it is still, you know, we are trying to create that, you know, reach to those consumers. So it's a continuous challenge. It's interesting. And for me, I'm looking forward to really seeing how things that I work on bring value. So it's all about consumers. It's all about bringing value and solving a need or a pain point.
Very, very vast, diverse experience that you have shared with us, your whole journey, Seema. You have shared one of the risks that you had taken while changing jobs from consulting to a completely B2C kind of a role. Any other failures that you would like to highlight, any particular challenges or risks that you would like to highlight?
It's not an easy one because we don't want to talk about our failures. No, I'm kidding. But no, I think I wouldn't say there has been any failure, or rather, I mean, it's a journey. I think what is important is to be able to trust in yourself to take that dip, take that risk. Because what I would say, what we women usually do is whenever we see a job, you know, we try to see if that does match 100% of your competencies, of our skills or not. We are not really, I mean, of course, I would say all of you women have really taken that, you know, sort of plunge, but for the message for those women out there, we try to match our, you know, skill set 100% to that job. And we think that we are not, you know, ready for it because, you know, it requires something more. But which is where I would say that, yes, it does not match. But I think we have acquired that in the previous position that you held, or even if you're a fresher, you're starting a new job, do trust in yourself, that capability to be able to learn on the job. And I think we women do great. So it's really about, you know, I had mentioned previously, that trust and confidence in yourself to take that. If you're passionate about it, go for it. So even though it would be something we feel it's crazy, but I think it's important to follow our passion. So every time we are doing things, following our passion. So that's what I have done. I mean, living in France was not something we had imagined. When we came to France, we thought like 2 years and maybe we are done. So it was really at that point where we were actually deciding to, you know, go back, because it's not an easy country to live in, you know, but then here we are 10 years later. And I have a 4-year-old daughter, and, you know, like, really, we could imagine ourselves living, you know, living here, because it's been a journey, and we have taken that risk. But we did also do things like, you know, learn learning the culture, learning the language, that really incorporates and integrates into this. So I would say that, yes, it's important to
keep picking up your stuff.
Pulling up our socks and, you know,
and
don't be afraid. I think it's okay to fail, but we should not be regretting later that we didn't even try. So I would definitely say that it's always, there's no U-turn. You always make, you discover a new road and it's a journey. So it's important to, you know, keep trying and, you know, pushing yourself harder.
What type of culture do you think is needed for a digital transformation or innovation? You are doing here a lot of digital transformation journeys and adopting newer stuff. So what kind of culture do you think is the best that has helped you all succeed in your transformation journey?
That's a great question. So I would say, people often, when we talk about transformation or digital transformation, they often confuse it with a tech transformation, just to say that, you know, we will upgrade the tech or bring things and it will happen. But that's not really true, because it is really about the culture that you create around not isolating digital and putting it in a silo. It's really about upskilling everybody. All the functions, be it sales, be it marketing, be it supply, how do we really, you know, upskill each one of them to think about using, you know, leveraging digital in their, you know, day-to-day functions. And it's really about a new way of doing things. So you're reaching out consumers where you're used to, you know, selling it in store, but now you're reaching out to new consumers, you're recruiting new consumers, or you're, you know, interacting with them in a new way. So it's really what I would say is that has been, you know, what I have learned. I mean, I would say one of the person that I really look up to, our mentor or role model, is Lubomira Roche. So she is the chief digital officer at L'Oreal, and she has been in this role where she came in and, you know, the role did not exist. So I have learned from her to say that, you know, it's not about saying that, okay, you know, you do this and it happens. But what she learned was it was all about it really upskilling the people who are there in the current function, bringing new digital talent, but infusing it with people who are already there doing those functions, and how we, you know, enrich the culture about looking at things in a different way and starting to build the digital as part of the whole journey. And what we have done as well, like where our team's role is, we are kind of the digital service and innovation role. So we know about, like, okay, you know, you have to improve your sales at e-commerce, like you know those objectives. But what we were doing are very different, because when we are talking about bringing services, it's about, like, it's not about selling your product anymore. It's really about, you know, women, for us, one of my major concerns is skincare. So we think about, okay, you know, how do I make my choice? I don't know. There are so many things out there. I don't know how to make my choice. There's so many products. So we came about this idea with a simple, you know, there is a need. Women need help in about choosing the right products for me. And so the vision was about, you know, creating services where we augment our products along with these services. And that's where we are. That's what we are doing every single day. During pandemic, I would say what the challenge we hit was the beauty experts that, you know, help you when you go to the store, give you, you know, advices like, okay, I can tell you that this product looks good on you, or this looks, you know, this is your skin looks dry, so, you know, choose this. They were not able to do that because the stores were closed and the consumers are stuck online, and they were having a more difficult problem about how do I make this choice. So, you know, I was working on a product, which was, I would say, was not at all, not yet the product market fit, was allowing consumers to connect to a beauty expert online, like, you know, teleconsultation, like we are doing Zoom, but it was about bringing it to the consumers when they are shopping on our website and bring it through the experts. So the real experts are brand experts. And so during pandemic, within 4 weeks, we actually brought the service, like created this experience, which allowed you, the consumers, to connect to a beauty expert, you know, do this live video. And not just that, we were also able to, you know, apply products like through the try-on technology. So you could, you know, we are talking and you're like, I want to find my foundation, because that's really very complicated today. We don't know always our right shade. So these experts were able to see the consumers and, you know, do that. So I would say what has been keeping on moving in terms of the transformation is a shared vision. So what are we looking at? To be resilient, and to be really like going for that test and learn. It's okay to, you know, keep fail, but you have to have that big bets. So teleconsultation, for example, was a big bet for us. We did not know how it would go, but you know, those are like, I would say the keywords, like take that big bet and then, you know, bring everybody together. So it's a journey, and you say that we have this shared vision, and then we go forward with a sense of purpose, with a sense of belonging, and the transformation, you know, it's like, it starts a chain reaction or a fusion. So everybody is, you know, really constantly upskilled to improve themselves, and say the culture is very important. So for us at L'Oreal, it's like a big thing about like mindset and culture, and we love that.
Good. You have been into tech industry, tech teams in India as well as in France. Is there any starking difference in the teams, the tech teams, the orientation or the way they work between India and France, or you think it is kind of similar?
So what I would say is, I think we are more women in tech when I compare to, you know, in France. So it's striking. But yeah, I would say that's a good news for India that we are, you know, pushing that. But I really appreciated the way Ritvika put it, because many times we women, you know, take it that back step about not prioritizing our career, and which is, I think, more prevalent in India when I compare to like the culture, not in generally with tech, but in professional women in France. The fact is like, you know, being a mother, like the motherhood doesn't really, you know, put a break in terms of their priorities professionally. So this, I would say, is a really something that I learned and I appreciated, because yes, you know, bringing a kid, you know, growing your family is equally, you know, enriching. But if you are a professional and you are really doing passionate about your work, there is no harm to take a break. But do not think that that break is forever. It's really about being confident to come back, and we all have a place. It's really, you know, taking that place. Which is important. So I would say women here, they do take their breaks, but they do not put their career on the back burner saying that, you know, I have now become a mother and, you know, my children need me, and then I would really, you know, sacrifice my career. So I would say that is where I think the balance becomes unequal. And I don't think that we should blame the men, because it's really, you know, us women who do not prioritize ourselves. And, you know, back when I have friends who have done that, and when I ask them, they are like, you know, I don't know, I feel like I, you know, I sometimes for their husband's careers or things like that, they try to, you know, did not come back to their professional working experience before, but after having kid. And they still feel regretted about it, because they're like, why did I, you know, when can I restart? So I would say definitely it's really important to restart. And the tech scene here, honestly, I mean, as you know, coming from outside, the first thing I did was to observe how are things working here and versus when the things are in India. Definitely, we Indians are coming with that openness about, you know, trying to fit in. So we always take our time to, you know, see how the things are and then find your place and bring the knowledge and the experience that you have gained. So that is what I have done in every place that I have been. I've taken the time to, you know, understand how things are done and then put your point about how you feel that based on my previous experience, things can be improved. And the tech scene here, I would say, honestly, I was not really part of a startup directly working or a tech company, because I have been part of, you know, for example, at LVMH, we are a fashion luxury brand. And then at L'Oreal, we are now becoming like a beauty tech company. Of course, we have our own tech teams, but, you know, I'm not part of directly the tech team, but more as a product. So there, I would say, you know, comparing to when I was at Celine or at L'Oreal, I am fortunate to work with so many women, because, you know, the workforce is really like, you know, there is an imbalance. I would say more women versus men, because, of course, L'Oreal being a marketing first and product first company, you have a lot of women who are there. And you same at luxury fashion, you know, you had a lot of women. So I was like, okay, it's so nice to be, you know, around women versus when you are used to in India, like being like maybe 20% women versus in tech. I mean, 20 to 30% to 70% men. It's a welcome change.
On that concluding note, what we agree, technology isn't scary. We all started with being a programmer or a non-programmer, software engineer, developer, and we have evolved into a business, into a leadership roles, or into roles where we are enabling businesses and solving day-to-day problems with technology. Being a woman in tech do not have to be confined by those definitions or profiles of technology. You can grow, evolve, and learn from the business aspect as well. To have a successful and satisfying career, I think the prerequisites are eagerness to solve problems and have a confident headspace. Just pick up those opportunities, try and gain things, pull up your socks, do your decisions every day, have the grit to follow it. And knowing the critical business pain areas and solving it with computational thinking are just key elements that will help women have their journey through a tech industry or a tech career. And that's exactly the message that Drona HQ is giving: coding or no coding, achieve digital solutions for your organization at speed. I think that's the end of, I'll wrap it up, end of a wonderful panel. Would love to thank you once again for coming up, sharing your experiences, sharing your profound knowledge that you have gained over years. Thank you so much.